Good evening. It's 8 o'clock. The top headlines today on another grim day. This as 23 people have died in a Karnataka hospital. Their families say the oxygen ran out. In Delhi, the state says code red now asks for army help to handle the current situation. Meanwhile, the government says we have no shortage of oxygen. This as there is a Supreme Court deadline to fix oxygen supply in Delhi by this midnight. India's cases dip, but this is as testing drops majorly and deaths are rising. The government says there are early signs of plateauing of cases in Delhi, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, but the surge is still climbing in most states. Final year medical students now to be deployed in COVID duty under supervision. NEET PG exams postponed for at least 4 months, and if you complete 100 days in COVID service, you get priority in government recruitment. People dying, but the Central Vista project going full steam. Today, environmental clearance granted for 13,500 crores today. Why don't we use that for vaccines? And deadline set. The new Prime Minister's residence will be ready by December 2022. Mamata is Chief Minister again. Her swearing-in is on Wednesday. Stalin and other Chief Ministers will be sworn in this week. Also, tackling COVID is our top priority, say all Chief Minister Alex. Our lead story tonight, the SOS for oxygen is now coming in from different parts of the country as Indians are dying not of COVID alone, but the fact that they have no oxygen. So desperate cry for oxygen across India. 24 patients died in a Karnataka hospital. Their patients' families say that they died because there was no oxygen when they needed it. Relatives claim also in a Madhya Pradesh hospital that people died because oxygen ran out. Again, officials have denied an oxygen shortage. But you can see the anger as they are outside. They are outside protesting. Government officials insist that it's got nothing to do with it, but this is what it is. Also in Uttar Pradesh, a sister's desperate bid to save their mother as they actually give her mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Tragic pictures there as sisters try to save their mother. The worst situation today really from Karnataka district near Mysore, with 23 COVID patients dying at a government district hospital in less than a day. Their patients say they died because there was no oxygen.
Tragedy in Karnataka's Chamarajnagar district, with 23 COVID patients dying at this government district hospital in less than a day. Relatives allege that a lack of oxygen caused at least some of the deaths. Rajana got an SOS call at midnight from his nephew, who had got married just a couple of months ago. The government has ordered an inquiry headed by an IAS officer on the deaths that happened between 9 a.m. on Sunday and 7 a.m. on Monday. The report should be submitted in 3 days' time. The hospital and authorities made efforts to meet the oxygen shortfall that occurred shortly after midnight. The MP from neighbouring Mysuru district from the BJP says he organised over 15 cylinders.
Ratrine Southern Gas Agency orna karsi. ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ 15 ಸಿಲಿಂಡರ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮೊದಲು 50 ಸಿಲಿಂಡರ್ ಪದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದು ರಾತ್ರಿ 3 ಗಂಟೆಗೆ ಮತ್ತೆ 60 ಸಿಲಿಂಡರ್ ಅನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಬೆಳಗ್ಗೆ 7 ಗಂಟೆಗೆ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಇಷ್ಟಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಒಂದು ಅವಘಡ ಸಂಭವಿಸಿರುವಂತದ್ದು ಬಹಳ ದುರದೃಷ್ಟಕರ ಸಂಗತಿ
The opposition Congress criticized the government over the deaths. Rahul Gandhi tweeted, "Died or killed? My heartfelt condolences to their families." Karnataka has been struck hard by the second deadly wave of the coronavirus. In this district, cases have shot up by almost 4,000 in the last 2 weeks. This has strained medical infrastructure. And now, this loss in Chamarajnagar, leaving so many grieving families. Maya Sharma for NDTV.
The tragedy of seeing the families of those patients dying not just of COVID but because they can't get oxygen. And today in Bengaluru, two hospitals have also sent out an SOS for oxygen. This as Bengaluru now has more cases than Delhi and Mumbai together. So they're really surging now. So two hospitals sending out SOS, Medax Hospital and RR Medical College. Both hospitals received oxygen then after it was tweeted by various politicians. But the fact that now the oxygen SOS now spreading to Bengaluru as well. But what does the government have to say at this time? Today, in the Health Ministry briefing, here's what the government actually said. They said India has enough oxygen. But we are asking, if India has enough oxygen, then why are patients dying because they don't get oxygen?
मैं सभी देशवासियों को आश्वस्त करना चाहूंगा कि ऑक्सीजन की मांग में वृद्धि होने के बाद भी देश में पर्याप्त मात्रा में ऑक्सीजन उपलब्ध है और साथ ही भविष्य में कोविड केसेस में अपेक्षा अनुसार कमी ना होने अथवा वृद्धि होने की आशंका को ध्यान में रखते हुए भारत सरकार विदेश से भी ऑक्सीजन इंपोर्ट कर रही है जिससे कि भविष्य में भी यह पर्याप्त मात्रा में उपलब्ध रहे
Enough oxygen says the government but let's ask the people who are fighting for this day in and day out Delhi and Gurugram's top doctors are joining us now from different hospitals as we discuss India's worst health crisis and the SOS for oxygen. Joining me is Dr. Sudhanshu Bankata from Batra Hospital, Dr. Devliana Chakravarti from Artemis, Dr. Jitendra Nagpal from Sitaram Bhartia and Dr. Sumit Ray of the Holy Family Hospital. Dr. Bankata, I have to go across first to you and express also my sincere condolences at the fact that a fellow doctor died at Batra Hospital on Saturday, just 2 days ago. Has the situation changed? We just heard the government saying India has enough oxygen. Then why is it that India's capital's hospitals are not getting oxygen?
The situation was all right, at least today. But what has happened, I've just received another order, which is dated today's, as per which our allocation is further reduced to 3.2 metric ton, whereas our daily requirement at the moment is 6.5 metric ton. So if that happens, it's a disaster in waiting and in making, because we cannot deprive 50% of the patients admitted of oxygen. And if half the day we are going to be without oxygen, I really cannot understand how we are going to pull through tomorrow. And the same, I think, has happened across the board with almost all the hospitals. Mm-hmm. Their allocation of oxygen has been reduced.
Let me just ask, because of course right now we're showing the picture of the doctor who died in Batra Hospital. What is it like for you, Dr. Bankata, and this to all the doctors on my panel, trying to organize oxygen? What are you going through? What is your medical staff going through? And what do doctors go through who see patients dying in front of them?
I have no words to answer that. Because what is actually happening is that my mornings are merging into nights. The nights are merging into nightmares. And I wake up to another nightmare. And I don't know whether it's day or night. It's an impossible situation. If we are going to survive on 50% oxygen, then of course, we are bound to lose 10 to 20% of patients tomorrow. If this is going to be the situation, it's appalling. It's simply appalling. I haven't had a minute's rest. I'm always on my phone throughout the day trying to organize one thing or the other. And it's all related to oxygen.
Dr. Sumit Ray, if you could come in here, why has the situation become worse? I remember our first SOS came in for oxygen about 10 days ago when a hospital called us and we couldn't believe here that hospitals were calling a television channel to reach out for oxygen. It's become worse today. Why has the situation reached where it is? And explain to us, we've seen so many cases when young people in their 20s and 30s are coming into emergency wards needing oxygen and they could be saved if they got that oxygen. Why? How would you ask? What would you ask the government today? How can we change this around and get them this oxygen when they say India has enough?
So Sonia, two things. One is the oxygen, and we surely are short of oxygen supply. I mean, in the sense that it must be produced enough, being produced, and even more reason to be. It's shameful that if we are producing enough, if we can't distribute enough, and people are dying of lack of oxygen. And every hospital in the NCR and other places are on the edge. We are constantly on the edge. It is not that the government officials at the local level are not working. They are also working day and night. But there is some problem with supply coming into Delhi, and that is why the, you know, constant cut and reduction in the supply that happens. In between, we had good supply for 2 days, and then again, it has been reduced. And it's a constant struggle. It's shameful. I mean, it's a country, we have aspirations to be a superpower, and we can't give our people oxygen. Having said that, it is not just oxygen. We have to realize that young people are dying because of lack of beds in the hospitals. So just increasing oxygen supply is not going to help. We have to understand the crisis is already there of hospital beds, ICU beds. The timeline of COVID is such that most of the patients who have, the numbers have surged, they are going to land up in the ICU now, in the second and third week of the surge. And we lack hospital beds, we lack ICU beds, we lack ventilators. What has to also be done along with the logistics of oxygen is increase the number of beds. It is like a disaster situation. We have to set up prefabricated hospitals, ventilators, ICUs immediately with staff. It cannot work like this. We are beyond our own capacities. Every hospital is working way beyond our capacities.
Absolutely. And I think one of the issues is that it's being left as each hospital for itself, whereas many experts have said this is a war that India is fighting. In a war, bring in every resource to focus only on this, set up the prefabricated. I'm glad today it was approved that now finally our medical students can also join in. But the larger issues, they can't produce oxygen, they can't produce beds. If you could come in also, because yesterday again, all our hearts were skipping a beat in the newsroom when we got calls from Sitaram Bhartia, Dr. Jitendra Nagpal. And again, we were being told that please put this on air because we will run out of oxygen in half an hour. What happens when you reach out to any government officials? The Delhi High Court has been hearing this now for a week, saying that nodal officers have to be responsible. They've asked the centre and the Delhi government to be responsible. The Supreme Court has given a deadline of midnight tonight for oxygen supply to be fixed. Is it fixed in your hospital? What would, if the Supreme Court was here, or you in the Supreme Court, what would you say today, sir, about what happened last night?
Seeking oxygen supplies, we explored and knocked on every door that was possible, including the administration, including the media, including politicians, including everything that we could think of. We started to get alarmed at around 11 in the morning when we realized that our usual supplier, you know, would not be able to supply us oxygen today because his tankers were empty. We were told that the oxygen supplies will arrive by a train, which is going to be probably arriving at Tughlakabad railway station, and the tanker is waiting. Now, I estimated that the oxygen supply is not going to be lasting till around, 4:35. And if the tanker is going to be waiting and the estimated arrival of the train was 4:45, we were, very, very tight with reference to the oxygen. So we sent out SMSs, we sent out Twitter feeds and, SOS messages to everybody. People were working on it, but what we understood was that the oxygen itself wasn't available. It was not as if the people didn't want to do something. The administration was trying, but I don't see that they were trying to reassure us. But what reassurance can I give? I have 50 patients on oxygen in the ICUs as well as the beds. Oxygen beds and the parents, we have pregnant women also, we have newborns also, premature babies also. No reassurance was good enough. We received around 20 cylinders at around 5:40 or so when we had almost run out of our tanks. Those 20 cylinders plus another 6 lasted for another 3-4 hours. We were having our own nightmares. The entire administration was, standing in the hospital.
Absolutely.
Finally, the tanker arrived at around 10:30. And we breathe the sigh of relief, but and this is a never-ending nightmare. I mean, what I'm saying is the story of one particular day, but there have been very narrow close misses or narrow escapes which have happened in the last few days where the cryo tanks have neared emptiness,
and then you'll have to manually start pumping using the ambulatory bags to actually revive, to keep patients alive. Dr. Chakravarti, if you can come in, because of course you're in Gurugram, but that's in the NCR area. Now, these are the best hospitals in India. This is the area which has the best healthcare available. And we are down to this. What would you say? How can we not fix this in 10 days? Especially when we are told again and again that there's 110% oxygen. The court is told, the Prime Minister and Home Minister are monitoring this. The Delhi government says we are on this, war room's up. How can we actually solve this? And what is it like for you as a medical administrator, a doctor right now in the National Capital Region?
Sonia, so the problem is real and there is a huge lack of oxygen. From Saturday early morning, 3 a.m., an entire Sunday, my entire team, our doctors, nurses, and myself in the forefront, we made hundreds of calls for oxygen. So we had two shifts of doctors and nurses in the intensive care with the ambu bags, backing up almost 72 ventilators to keep the pressure on. So these are times that we have never seen in our lives as doctors. So if the whole day went on ambu and doctors are breaking down in the ICU, shedding tears to see what they have to go through. And, it was like a war room and we did not know what to do. If the government is saying there is an oxygen, there is no dearth of oxygen, then they have to look at what is happening to the supply chain. Mm-hmm. And everybody in Gurugram, the administration, of course, they picked up my phone. They assured it will come. But then somehow the tanker did not roll in. And if it did, the oxygen which was given would barely last for a couple of hours. So doctors and nurses and paramedics, huge amount, you can understand, 72 yes. ventilators and 100 more people Absolutely. On ambus to, taking shifts. It was like a relay race to maintain the pressure. So there is a problem with the supply chain, or there is a supply problem with the distributor. Till I finally reached out to private corporates mm-hmm. and till their tanker rolled in. And that was the time we kind of, having said that, I would say that twice the tanker from the government came, but it gave us almost 1/5 or 1/6 of our supply, which was like, another 2 hours and another 3 hours. And no. everybody in Gurugram administration are working, but the oxygen is not there.
Absolutely. So, I mean, just listening to how harrowing it is, I think the problem is that if you don't identify the problem, how will you resolve it? And I think that's
course.
Where we need to be honest about it. And just Dr. Bankata, as we come back and we talk about the harrowing thing, what is it like for doctors when you lose patients, we reported today in a Karnataka hospital, 24 patients, Batra hospital, 12 people, including a fellow doctor. How do the doctors recover and go back to work with that sense of hope that they have to give the patients, that they will give them the best possible care? What is it like when you lost also a fellow doctor?
It is extremely painful. We are extremely saddened by the loss. He was such a delightful person. He was such a happy-go-lucky kind of a person, always cheerful. He was always around for almost everybody, including the doctors, his patients, his colleagues, his nurses, everybody. Mm-hmm. This gentleman we lost, it was very, very sad for us. But, since we are all trained as doctors, nurses, and healthcare professionals, we have to actually just pick ourselves up again
yes.
and start functioning again. So we try and do that. But then every time that we get to hear the news that tomorrow will be another far more compromised day, it just breaks us up again. I shudder to imagine what will happen if this order stands and we get only 3.2 metric ton tomorrow. See, the challenges of the moment and of the future, they are eclipsing every bit of sadness, every bit of reaction. We are like numbed at the moment.
I can understand. And Dr. Ray, if you could come in on that how, you know, in fact, today in the High Court, again, there was an argument that whether Batra Hospital took oxygen meant for somebody else, or whether X hospital tankers are being, whether Haryana is trying to hold on to tankers over Delhi. How do we actually resolve this? And it's not about bits and pieces in each hospital, obviously trying to save their patients. Dr. Ray, what is a more holistic solution you would urge the governments, all governments, center, states, to look at now?
I mean, I think the principles of cooperative federalism is what we have to look at. With the center watching over, helping all other states working together, looking at the demands and seeing where is this more surge, not because one state is governed by one party or another state is governed by another party. It cannot happen like that.
And Dr. Nagpal, what would you say, Sitaram Bhartia have oxygen enough for the next 2 days? What would you appeal today?
So, well, there are two appeals. One is that I would appeal to anybody who can help, you know, resolve this crisis, which is upon Delhi, I would say, and Delhi NCR. I think they should put their best foot forward, as Dr. Ray pointed out, without any considerations, try to resolve this issue. Because what is happening is that it is tearing the ethical, moral, emotional fabric of healthcare. It is, you know, this COVID crisis, we are faced with multiple difficulties. We are refusing patients because of lack of beds. We are, you know, the admitted patients are strained out by the, you know, limited oxygen available. The doctors are really working in trying conditions, trying to do their best. And at best, what you can do is provide some logistical support. You know, don't make people in the hospital administration, as well as, you know, these are doctors who can really do better clinical care.
They shouldn't be worrying about the next supply of oxygen. Dr. Chakravarti, final thoughts from you tonight, and we hope every stakeholder in this is watching.
Sonia, we have, you know, pretty much we have now stepped up, and we have realized that hospitals, especially the bigger hospitals, have to take matters in their own hand. So I have already sent out orders for 2 oxygen plants, and which is good, which will take around 3 weeks. I know it's 3 weeks, but then in 3 weeks, we should have at least 60% of our supply generated in-house. So that has been done. 60 oxygen concentrators more have been ordered from across the globe, so that my patients who are in the wards at least can have that as a use. So I think each hospital will also have to do a little bit of their bit, because it is a crisis which is unforeseen, and we have to find ways how we are going to help ourselves. Because
Absolutely.
If you keep waiting every day for that tanker to come in, mm-hmm. You know, we are not going to be able to work. The morale of our doctors are going to be low. So we have to tell them, we are with you in this fight, and I'm going to generate the oxygen that I need, and sooner than later, and help
you
guys.
And of course, Dr. Chakravarti, these are some of Delhi's and Gurgaon's big hospitals. But the worry, of course, is small hospitals and what happens to them. But thank you all for expressing your thoughts. And again, I have to say that, I mean, our admiration for all of you and all doctors and healthcare workers at this time is really manifold for the heroic work you're doing. Thank you all very much for joining us on NDTV. Let's just have a quick look at the data, because that's what really counts. Well, India's active caseload has now passed the 34 lakh mark with 368,147 new cases. That is 6% lower, however, than yesterday's spike. Deaths, however, are at 3,407, so they're rising as well. But let's just look at why there's been that dip in cases. The testing has also been less. That really is the reason that why these cases are coming down. So if you just look at those figures, at how much the tests have actually dropped, the earlier the cases were almost 4 lakh a day, is now down to 3.68. But the real number could be far higher, because there's been a big fall in the number of tests conducted. So given the positivity rate of 24% today, that means many more cases may have been missed because of the low testing. However, the government today said that they're actually looking at perhaps early signs of plateauing in some states, including Chhattisgarh, Maharashtra and Delhi. They said these are very early signs, but the surge is still on in many more states.
If we analyze the last 24 hours of data, we see 367,000 cases. So maybe in cases, we are seeing some reduction in cases, but these are very early signals. We need to analyze it and do related efforts. कंटिन्यूड बेसिस पर जरूरत है, यह भी हम आप लोगों की दृष्टि में लाना चाहेंगे। इसी तरीके से अगर हम रिपोर्टेड डेथ को देखें तो पाते हैं कि अगर कल यानी कि पिछले 48 घंटे पहले अगर उसमें देखें तो 3689 डेथ अगर रिपोर्ट हुई थी तो पिछले 24 घंटे में 3417 डेथ भी रिपोर्ट हुई हैं। अर्ली सिग्नल्स ऑफ प्लैटोइंग उत्तर प्रदेश में भी दिखते हैं।
So early case of plateauing in Uttar Pradesh, but good news there on Mumbai's cases there dropping below 3,000. But meanwhile, in other news, well, a deadline has been set for the Prime Minister's new house amid India's worst health crisis. It's today got environmental clearance, a green all clear. The Prime Minister's residence and the SPG headquarters will be ready by December 2022 and the Vice President's house by May next year. The project is under the Central Vista, costing nearly 13,500 crores. Remember, why couldn't that money go perhaps for vaccine? The opposition insists that the government should actually spend instead 35,000 crores for free vaccines for all. Well, a quick look at some other news. New chief ministers all to be sworn in this week. There's the Kerala chief minister, the elect also now meeting the governor there. And Mamata Banerjee also met the governor this evening. M.K. Stalin, after a meeting, is also likely to be sworn in this week. And there's the Puducherry chief minister elect as well. So all the new chief ministers getting ready and all of them saying their first priority is COVID.